वार्म गुड इवनिंग टू एवरीवन। होप यू आर ऑल सेफ एंड डूइंग गुड। सो स्क्वाड मेडिसिन एंड रिसर्च इन एसोसिएशन विद जेपी मेडिकल पब्लिशर्स इज होस्टिंग अ कंटिन्यूस मेडिकल एजुकेशन प्रोग्राम फॉर ऑल मेडिकल एंड हेल्थ केयर स्टूडेंट्स अक्रॉस द इंडिया। सो टुडे आई वेलकम यू टू द फोर्थ डे ऑफ द मेडिनवेन एंड नाउ वी हैव सेकेंड सेशन ऑफ आवर डे मेडिकल सर्टिफिकेशन ऑफ कॉज ऑफ डेथ बाई डॉक्टर गौतम बिस्वास। Today we are happy that we have our honorable speaker Dr. Gautam Biswas sir. So a little introduction about him. Dr. Gautam Biswas was born in Calcutta and did his schooling from Shyama Prasad Vidyalaya Lodhi Estate, New Delhi. Sir did his MBBS and MD Forensic Medicine from University College of Medical Sciences and GTB Hospital, Delhi. Sir began his career in 2001 as a lecturer in forensic medicine and toxicology at Dayanand Medical College and Hospital, Ludhiana, Punjab, India, where he is presently working as professor and head. DMC is one of the topmost private medical colleges in India as per various rating agencies in India. Sir has presented many papers and chaired sessions in national conferences, workshops and seminars. In the year 2009, his book Review of Forensic Medicine and Toxicology was published. Within a few years, it became a bestseller in category of forensic textbooks, and it has been appreciated by undergraduate and postgraduate students alike. Currently, the fifth edition, which has been published a few months back, is a fully colored textbook based on recent MCA guidelines, which is competency-based medical based undergraduate curriculum for the Indian medical graduate, released in 2018. His other notable contributions in this specialty are the recent advances in Forensic Medicine and Toxicology, Volume 1-3, as editor for the postgraduates, faculty, and medical practitioners working in an emergency setup. Sir has contributed a state of art practical and postmortem record book in Forensic Medicine and Technology in 2015. This book has been modified as per current MCA guidelines and renamed as Manual of Forensic Medicine and Toxicology and is currently available for students. So, today we have our topic, medical certification of cause of death, how to write it correctly. We are very grateful to have you on our conference, sir. Now the stage is yours. Sir, you are in mute, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes, sir.
Thank you for the introduction and greetings to all the students and ladies and gentlemen. I am thankful to JP Brothers Medical Publishers as well as the Squad Medicine and Research for giving me this opportunity to discuss one of the important documents that is to be made by a medical officer, a medical practitioner. After, you can say, at the end of your 4.5 years of MBBS and during the time of internship, you should be able to write this document, that is the medical certification of cause of death. I have taken this topic because I have seen during these years that this document is not properly made at all in any of the institute, be it in any premier institute. This is taken very lightly, and most of the time it is incomplete. And the doctor who is filling it up, they are not sure what to write. Most of the time, it is the diagnosis that is being written in the medical MCCD, the medical certificate of cause of death certificate. That is usually the form 4 that is being filled up by the certifier or the practitioner. So it is a very important certificate, and you should be knowing the basic. I thought that it should be useful to you, those who are right now in second prof, third prof, or final prof. They should be aware of it, and by the time you resident doctor, you should be well versed in writing this MCCD. So I'll start with this, with the brief introduction of the. A brief introduction of what is MCCD. The medical certificate of cause of death the shorter version is MCCD, is commonly called the death certificate. Common people say it's a death certificate. It's the most frequently issued certificate by a government medical practitioner, invariably in the government setup, when a hospital or death is occurring. But it's not that common for a private practitioner. Those who are general GPs and all, they are not usually preparing the MCCD, but they should be knowing about it. That is how to write a medical certificate of cause of death. This document has immense medical and legal importance. Many doctors do not fill it up correctly, and it is because of the ignorance. Mostly it is ignorance, and maybe at some length it is because of indifference. But there is no accountability of that. If you have made it whatever way it is going, and no one is asking whether you have done it correctly, not correctly, no one is saying. That's why there's a lot of indifference is there for this certificate. Why it is important that you fill it up correctly? Under the Act of Registration of Births and Deaths of 1969, registration of births and deaths is mandatory. Registration of not only of occurrence of death, but the cause is also equally important. How the death has occurred, what is the cause, that is also important. Statistical analysis of the causes of death forms is important for morbidity and mortality statistics, and which is the backbone of the national health policy and planning. So you are getting involved with the national health policy and planning. And if you're this data that you are supplying, if it is incorrect, then everything gets nullified. So wrong diagnosis, you have made a wrong diagnosis, or incorrect filling up of the certificate result in gross error in the mortality statistics, directly affecting the formulation of the national health policy. So you should be very careful when preparing this document. Studies have revealed that approximately 50 to 60% of the MCCD submitted to test registering authorities are incorrectly filled up. But I think that it is little bit on the lower side. I believe it is about 70 to 80% of the certificate which is not properly filled up. So how it is done? Registration of this death, for registering a death, identity of the deceased is required, date and time of death, and cause of death, which we provided to the registering authority. So identity of that person, date and time of that death, and cause of death is required. If any of these details are not available, death cannot be registered. So all these details are required for registration. I thought of like it should be a little bit of interactive sort of lecture. It shouldn't be a monotonous one way. So you can send your, I'll be asking in between some questions so that you can send it in the, your response, you can send it in the chat box. Okay. So first, before we go into this cause of death, we should understand these terms: cause of death, mechanism of death, manner of death, mode of death. So without that, you will not be able to fill that form properly. Should understand what is the meaning of cause of death, mechanism of death, manner of death, mode of death. So it's all these terms are different. So what is cause of death? Cause of death is any injury or disease producing physiological derangement, briefly or over a prolonged time. So it may be brief, it may be acute, or it may be a chronic one, which results in the death of that individual. So it produces any injury or disease. It may be an injury or disease, and which produces a physiological derangement, and that may be brief or prolonged, and that resulted in the death of the individual. So for example, it can be a gunshot injury to the abdomen, any chest. It may be a gunshot injury, a stab wound to the chest, or adenocarcinoma of the lung. So a normal, so can say natural for adenocarcinoma of the lung, or coronary atherosclerosis that may cause MI. So these are the all causes of death: gunshot injury, stab wound, adenocarcinoma. Remember that these are the cause of death. So what is mechanism of death? It is a physiological derangement. You have physiological derangement produced by the cause of death that results in death. So what is the derangement that has been caused by this, say, gunshot injury? Gunshot injury will cause hemorrhage. So that is a mechanism of death. So for example, hemorrhage, septicemia, burn may cause septicemia, metabolic acidosis, alkalosis, renal failure may cause that. So ventricular fibrillation or respiratory paralysis. So these are the mechanism of death that has been brought about by this cause of death. So a particular mechanism of death can be produced by multiple causes of death and vice versa. So one mechanism can be have multiple causes. I'll just elaborate it in a short way from now. So manner of death, it explains the cause of how this cause of death came about. So it can be categorized as natural. How this cause of death came, it may be a natural way of the, like it may be an MI. So natural death, it may be a carcinoma or homicide, someone stab a person or shoot a person or suicide. It may be an accident, road traffic accident, or it can be undetermined when you're not sure how it has happened. By examination, investigation, all, you are not able to determine how this manner of death. A cause of death may have multiple manners of death. Now, to explain it in a better way, the cause, mechanism, and manner. An individual may die of massive hemorrhage. Massive hemorrhage is the mechanism of death due to stab wound of the heart. That is the cause of death. Stab wound of the heart is the cause of death. With the manner being, can be homicide. Someone stabbed him, but maybe suicide. He stabbed himself or at accident, he fell over the weapon, or it may be undetermined. I'm not sure how this has happened. So I hope that you have understood the difference between cause, mechanism, and manner. Right? Just to give you this cause of death, mechanism of death, and manner in a manner of death in a more elaborate manner, you can see that here you have got the hemoperitoneum. There is blood in the peritoneal cavity. So hemoperitoneum, which is caused due to laceration of the aorta, and this is further, it has been caused by blunt thoracic trauma. So it is the initially, it has been the blunt thoracic trauma that has caused the laceration. If you go the from below upwards, blunt thoracic trauma has caused laceration to the aorta, and which has resulted in hemoperitoneum. The mechanism is hemorrhagic shock, and the manner of death is the accident. It may be a road traffic accident, which has caused blunt thoracic trauma, resulting in laceration of aorta and hemoperitoneum. And the mechanism is that the person died of shock, hemorrhagic shock, right? Clear up to this part?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next week, that here also the other term that is left out is the mode of death. That is, if you go to most of the medical certificate of cause of death, you will find that it is written cardiorespiratory arrest, cardiopulmonary arrest. Most of the, I'll show you some of the reports also. You'll find that it is written, but actually it should not be written. That is what is said, even in the form it is mentioned, that do not mention. But it is being mentioned. Repeatedly you will see it is being mentioned. So mode of death, it refers to the abnormal physical state that pertained at that time of death. So that is a physiological state that has happened at the time of death. What is the abnormal physiological state? Which may be a coma. The person may be in coma at that time. It may be a congested cardiac failure. It may be cardiorespiratory failure, it may be a cardiac arrest or pulmonary edema. So if you are mentioning all these things, any one of these things, but you should mention along with it the etiology, how it has happened. Without this, it is incomplete. The cause of death is incomplete, right? So if the person is coma, you should mention why this special person is in coma. Coma, it should not be mentioned as such as in the cause of death. You should avoid mentioning the mode of death. Now, what is the role of a medical practitioner? When he is there in front of a dead body, when he has confronted with death of a person, what he should do? The doctor has two tasks at hand. The first is to diagnose the occurrence of death, that death has occurred, and declare the person dead, that the person is dead. He should diagnose it, the death of the person, and declare the person dead. He issue a death report. And the second is to decide the cause of death and certify the same. That is, issue the medical certificate of cause of death. That is MCCD. In short, it is called MCCD. Issuing this MCCD is done immediately after deciding the person is dead. provided that he is absolutely certain of the cause of death, that he should have, but he shouldn't have any ambiguity of the cause of death, that this is the cause and it is a natural death. So then only he should issue this MCCD. The doctor should have attended the deceased during his terminal illness, this or within 14 days prior to his death. This is preferably, it is not mandatory here, it is not mentioned here, but it is there in UK that he should have attended this patient within the last 14 days, or he should have attended this prior during his terminal illness. Then only he should issue it. And you should keep in mind that you are doing this sort of, that you are Peter, you are sure of this cause of death. Death due to old age and death due to any naturally occurring disease or its complication are natural deaths. You keep it in your mind that the death may be of old age or maybe because of any natural occurring disease or its complication, that will be considered as a natural death. Otherwise, all other deaths should be considered unnatural deaths. And you shouldn't issue the MCCD. Then correct knowledge of the cause of death is essential, as future course of action is different if the death is other than natural cause or cause of death is not known or doubtful. How you are going to deal with that person is different if it is the case is unnatural one or you are not knowing about it. So any death unattended by the doctor, they are to be reported as medical legal death. I will not go into that part of medical legal death. We'll consider only how to fill up this form. So it should be natural death. You should be aware of it, how the person has died during the terminal illness. If it is admitted, if you know that this has happened, then only you can issue MCCD. Now, it is important to note that you should not delay in issuing the MCCD once you are sure that of the cause of death. There shouldn't be any delay in issuing of the certificate. You shouldn't charge any fees for issuing this certificate, and you should not withhold the issuance of MCCD even if your dues are not cleared by the relatives. So even if the dues, pending dues are there, you shouldn't withhold the issuance of this MCCD. And mind you, this is also important. There are some situations where the doctor may have signed with the death certificate earlier because maybe of some any reason. You should not, your doctor should not sign the MCCD in advance. That is before the individual has died or without viewing and examining the dead body personally. You shouldn't believe on whatever that someone may call you on phone and say that you are dead, the person so and so is dead, and fill up the certificate. You are not going to do it until and unless you have observed or examined the person or patient yourself, right? So how is filled up MCCD form, how it is filled up? This is the important part which I just want to highlight here. This is the international format of certifying the cause of death, and is defined by the WHO, the World Health Organization has made a certificate. The certificate is followed everywhere, and this is an international format. The first portion of this form gives the available information about the personal particulars of the deceased, including the date and time of death. So the first portion of the, I'll just show you the form. The first portion of this form gives the particulars of the patient or of the disease. And the other, that below it is the form that gives the cause of death and is divided into two parts, part one and part two, right? So first, the upper portion that gives the particulars of that person, and the below it is the cause of death, which is further subdivided into part one and part two. And below that, it is the manner of death is given. So this is the medical certificate of cause of death. The form 4 usually it is called, it is for the institutional death, hospital inpatient death. 4A is there for non-institutional death. So this is for medical certification of cause of death. You can see that the name of the hospital. Some hospitals have got their own printed format, so that is not required to be filled up. Then you have got, this is the particulars of that deceased person that you have to right fill it up. The columns that need to be filled up is one, the important thing that you should remember, that this is not for you to fill up. This portion is not for you, but does say name, sex, age, that you have to, male, female, you have to write. You have to take this. Then it comes the cause of death. You have, can see that there is immediate cause is mentioned. This is our old format. You have got now, it has got A, B, C, and D. So that D has also been included. And in, it has got part one and part two. So it, it, here also you can see clearly that it is mentioned the state, the disease, injury, or complication which caused death, not the mode of dying, such as heart failure, asthenia. Then asthenia is there because of weakness, malnutrition, whatever it is. So you are not going to mention all this. It should mention the disease or injury that has caused the complication which has caused. It is mentioned within the form. But what is happening then, invariably, you will see that if you go to your hospital also, you'll find that most of the doctors, resident doctors, they are filling it up and they are writing it cardiopulmonary arrest, cardiorespiratory failure. This is what is being written. And part two is for the other significant condition contributing to the death, but not related to the death or condition. We'll discuss step by step. And the below it is the manner of death. And if the special circumstances, whether it is a female, whether pregnancy was there or not, and whether the delivery was there, you have to mention. And this is the portion where you have to sign. You have to put your signature and your date of certification and date and time and your registration number. And this below it, sorry. Below it, this portion is handed over to the relative. You have to tear it up and it is handed over to the relative. So we'll discuss all these parts. So what is the part one of the MCCD? It's part one A. The A, if we go back to it, you can see that they have A, B, C, and D. I have told you that D is there. So part one A describes the condition that led directly to the death. This is immediately. So the immediate cause of death, it may be pulmonary embolism, it may be a hemorrhage, it may be asphyxia, it may be immediate. What is the immediate cause of death that may have caused the death of the person? So it is further subdivided into subsection like B, C, and D. After A, we have got B, C, and D. So they are the antecedent cause. The last one will be the underlying cause. So these are for the disease processes that have led directly to the death that are causally related to one another. They should be causally related to one another, that A being due to or consequent on B. So B happened, so A happened because of B, which in turn is due to the consequent on C, and B is because of C, and C is because of D. So they are in sequence. So I hope it is clear that A being due to consequent on B, C, and which is, and the C is due to consequent on D. These are the antecedent cause. Antecedent cause means that it existed before or there logically precedes the one the another. So they are the antecedent cause. It was present beforehand. Right, so we'll explain it better with some examples. So this is the new format. You can see that it is A, B, C, and D is there. The disease condition, antecedent condition. And the last one, we can say, if you elaborate it further, it will be the underlying cause, the last one, the underlying cause. So, and other significant condition contributing to the death, but not related to the disease or the condition causing. Here also it is mentioned that you should not mention heart failure, respiratory failure. So information under one, that is part one, pertains to the underlying cause of death, written from below upwards, clearly depicting the sequence of events ending with immediate cause, written under A. So it starts with the A is the immediate cause, and what is started, it should be there in the B. So B has caused A, it's like that, or C has caused B, B has caused A. So it is in the sequence C, B, A. So consequently, if there is no chain of events and underlying cause is the only event, it should be entered under A, as it is both the immediate and so if the immediate and underlying cause. So if there is no other events that has caused the death, if it is only one cause, you are going to put it under part one A. So there is the both the immediate and antecedent cause are the same one. There is no other cause related to it. Any cause that is related to the immediate cause. So evidently the line A must always have an entry. So if anything is there, there may be missed, the B, C, D may not be there, part 2 may not be there, but A should always be filled up. So the disease circumstances or accident or circumstances of accident or violence which started the chain is the underlying cause of death. So whatever started it is the underlying cause of death. And the subsequent events in the chain are called the antecedent cause, and the last one will be the immediate cause in that order. I hope it is clear now. So it starts with an underlying cause, then it will cause some antecedent cause, and the last, before death, it will be the immediate cause of death in that order. It is important to realize that the disease lowest in the part one list is the most important, as it is the primary condition, the start of the events leading to death. So whatever is the in the lowest in the part of, if it is there, you have filled up A, B, C, D, the D portion will be the most important and the primary condition which has started this events that lead to death of that person. So due thought should be given to the last entry of the part one, as it is picked up for statistical purpose as underlying cause of death. So you should be very careful in writing the part one. So, and the last one is very important, and I think that it's picked up for statistical purpose as the underlying cause of death. So now you can see that now we are having the pandemic COVID-19. So those who are in the emergency and all, they have to fill up the, those who are doing duties in COVID wards, they have to fill up the death certificates. But I have seen most of the times they are not filled up properly. So if the person, see here, it should be very clear that the person has first tested positive for COVID-19 14 days back. After 10 days, so he 2 weeks prior, he tested for COVID-19. Then 10 days prior to his death, he developed pneumonia. And 2 days prior to his death, he developed ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome, he developed. And he died subsequently because of ARDS. So you can see that the time interval is mentioned here. Started with 14 days prior. So you have this COVID-19, in bracket you can write the test is positive. And then he developed pneumonia, and then it is a sequence, 14 days, 10 days, 2 days. So it started and it culminated the death of the person with ARDS. So it is very clear in this that how to fill the part one. Now there are some situation. I just described briefly some of the situation where maybe we have only one cause. Then when the death is due to lobar pneumonia and there is no other additional cause of death, so it is the underlying antecedent and immediate cause of death. So hence you write lobar pneumonia in part A. And B, C, D will be left vacant. Clear? And sometimes it's been asked, what about the old age death? How we are going to write? So death due to old age is also a natural death, and the underlying cause of death there is entered as senility under 1A. However, this shouldn't be written in general, but it should be written only when senility is, as underlying cause of death is to be entered only when there is no other disease or its complication has caused death. So you should make sure that it is the old age that has caused, and there is no other cause that you can find to write in that column of cause of death. There's no other disease condition or complication that has caused death. Then only you write senility. Otherwise, try to find out what could have been the cause of this death. So what is the instruction you have to follow in writing the MCCD? It is the best opinion, medical opinion you are giving regarding the cause of death. So opinion you are forwarding to the authorities. So it should be the best possible opinion. So it has to be filled up by the doctor who has got full knowledge of the events which led to death. So the doctor should be involved in the treatment of the patient and should have full events which led to the death of the person. And this is very important. Please remember, please, this is what I want you to remember while writing the cause of death. Names of the disease should be written in full and legibly, preferably in block letters. This is never done. And abbreviation and short forms of diseases should not be used, and this is frequently done. So they are not written legibly, usually not in capital letters. Abbreviations are used rampantly. So you should avoid using abbreviation, because the person will be filling it up. They are non-medical, mostly they are maybe non-medical person who are sitting there filling it up. So they will not be aware of what the abbreviation means. And abbreviation is different in different parts of India. There are some abbreviations which are more common locally. So you should avoid giving writing the abbreviation in the form or short form of the disease. And the disease should be written in full. Keep in mind, two or more conditions should not be written on a single line. This also you should keep in mind. When the sequence consists of more than four entries, so A, B, C, D, it is more than that, then more than one condition may be entered on one line, maintaining the correct causal relationship. So you have to see that you have to, if you are ready, you can write it down, but the causal relationship should be maintained. It shouldn't be mixed up. Terminal events like circulatory failure, respiratory failure, etc. are modes that we have already discussed, that they are the modes of dying and should be avoided, as they are no more than signs of death and provide no useful information as to the underlying disease process. So you should keep in mind that you shouldn't write circulatory failure, respiratory failure in the cause of death certificate. Even if you are writing, mind you that if you are writing, write the etiology of that. And you should avoid that. These are signs, if you remember those who have passed forensic, they should know that we have discussed that early signs of death, the immediate signs of death, the immediate signs of death, we have taught to circulatory failure, respiratory failure. So you are not going to write this in a sense as cause of death. So this is an actual MCCD. You can see that what's being written, cardiopulmonary arrest. Simply it has been written like that. So this is not at all acceptable. This is total no-no. You are not going to write this sort of medical certificate of cause of death. So what is the part two of the MCCD? Part two is for other conditions not related to those listed in part one that have also contributed to death. That is the contributory cause. So it is not related to exactly when the death has occurred. It may not be related, but that's contributed in some way to this main event. If the individual is suffering from any other disease which is not related to underlying cause and hence cannot be part of the sequence, but in the opinion of the certifier has contributed to the death, such condition is to be recorded in the part two of the MCCD. So if it has contributed in any way in the death of the person, then only you are going to write it. Otherwise, you are not going to write it in the part two. Even you are not going to write that in the part two of the MCCD. However, if the coexisting disease has not contributed to the death, it has no place in the MCCD. You have to keep in your mind that thus the certificate, unlike medical record, is not a list of diseases which the individual was suffering from at the time of death. So you're not going to write all the conditions that person is suffering from in the contributory cause. So it is not a record. It is just, you have to mention if it has contributed to his death, the death of the person in any way. It should not be used as a basket for all the minor pathologies. Now you can see that we can go to back to the same case which we discussed in part of COVID-19 pneumonia. COVID-19 disease was there 10 days prior to his death, and he developed pneumonia at the same time when he was diagnosed, and he died up, and he developed acute respiratory ARDS 2 days prior to his death, and he died because of that. And you can see that he contributed in the part two of this MCCD, he had cerebral palsy for 10 years. So it may have caused the death, because there may be some issues with coughing and he's not able to clear his throat and all that may be there. So it may have contributed in it. So it is the best judge will be the person who is treating that person, the deceased. So it is not necessary to complete part 1B, 1C, 1D or part 2 if there are no predisposing conditions. So now I'll just highlight this fact. In the case scenario one, a patient died suddenly due to intracerebral hemorrhage due to hypertension. The cause of death will be, yes, you can respond to that. What will be part one, part two? Yes. So I just. Yeah, you can send me your response here. So if the patient dies suddenly due to intracerebral hemorrhage due to hypertension, the cause of death will be 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, 2, what could be the cause of death? Yes. You can send your intracerebral hemorrhage. This is 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, 2, what? Yeah, intracerebral hemorrhage, yeah, fine. It is 1A. One B. So intracerebral hemorrhage as such has caused death of the person. Why it should be part two of that that he contributed to that intracerebral hemorrhage. So intracerebral hemorrhage will be 1A and part 2 will be hypertension. He was having hypertension. It has not been mentioned, but he was having, but that resulted in intracerebral hemorrhage. And if the same patient, like if you just analyze it, take it a little further, and if the same patient survived for few days and weeks and developed pneumonia, the death certificate will record both the procedures. What should be the death certificate like then? He developed pneumonia. First he developed intracerebral hemorrhage, then he developed. So it will be pneumonia, bronchopneumonia first, 1A. 1B will be intracerebral hemorrhage, part 2 remains the same. The cause will be cause of death. Here statistically the cause of death will be intracerebral hemorrhage. Now, 1A will be pneumonia, 1B will be intracerebral hemorrhage, and 2 will be hypertension. So I'll elaborate, I'll give some more examples later on. You will find that. So statistically, you will find that it is statistical, both certificates will record primarily the underlying cause and as the intracerebral hemorrhage. So in case of diabetes mellitus, dying of septicemia due to gangrene of lymph, what will be the cause of death here in MCCD? In case of diabetes mellitus, dying of septicemia due to gangrene of lymph. Hypertension was there, it was a contributory cause because this has not immediately resulted in the sequence of event. So it was a cerebral hemorrhage that has caused immediate death of the person. That means not having that case because immediately it has not caused death of the person. So having for the person having septicemia, hypertension for maybe a few years, maybe that's why in part two. Yeah. Diabetes mellitus, yeah. Now it will be clear to you. We were septicemia 1A, 1B will be gangrene of lymph, and 1C will be diabetes. Why here? You will ask why here diabetes mellitus here? Because it is the gangrene of lymph developed because of here the diabetes of that patient. And if it suppose that gangrene of lymph developed because of some other condition and he may had diabetes earlier, maybe you can say gangrene developed because of frostbite or maybe some object falling on it, then you have to write that frostbite in 1C. Diabetes mellitus then will come to part two of the MCCD. So it is a dynamic form. You have to see the case and then decide. So diabetes mellitus here has resulted in gangrene. The gangrene is a direct consequence of his diabetes, and that has resulted in septicemia. And suppose the patient developed this gangrene because of frostbite, then you would have written frostbite, gangrene of limb, septicemia, and part two would have been diabetes mellitus. Am I clear now? So part two will be nil here. Yeah, but so time interval, we come the time we have to, most of the time we have seen that the time is not being mentioned properly. Having entered the condition sequentially, the duration of existence of each one of them is to be reflected under the heading interval between the onset and death, in that under the heading approximately that time. This entry will give the chronology of the events and thus ensure the correctness of the sequence. Regarding the date and time of death, the date and time at which the certificate decides that the individual is dead, that is somatic death, is the date and time of death. The actual time of death in medical legal cases is decided during the postmortem examination along with the cause of death. The most important part of the certificate is the portion giving details of the cause of death. The certifier signs the certificate giving his name, qualification, designation, and registration number. That is, I have found lacking in most of the certificate. The designation, registration number is not there. They have just put the signature and maybe sometimes the date is there. Otherwise, it's not there. The qualification, designation, registration should be there. The date and time of signature will be same as the date and date mentioned in the beginning of the certificate. At whatever time the person died, it will be the same, the date and time of signature. The bottom portion of the, as I have already mentioned you earlier also, the bottom portion of the MCCT is to be filled up by the certificate, detached, and handed over to the relatives. This document enables them to get the municipal permission for cremation as well as access reference to obtain the death certificate from the registering authority. It may be noted that this portion handed over to the relatives does not mention the medical cause of death. What is the portion that does not mention the medical cause of death that is handed over to the relatives? The certifier should send the MCCD along with the death forms to the registering authority directly. Now, case discussion. The picture will be more clear. It's a detailed one. The earlier, whatever we have just given you the summary of it, so it may be some confusion may be there. A 65-year-old male was admitted to the hospital with progressive right lower quadrant pain for the last 4 to 5 months. The patient had lost about 20 kgs with progressive weakness and malaise. He was a chronic alcoholic and hypertensive. On examination, the patient had an enlarged liver span, 3 finger breadths below the right costal margin. Rectal examination was normal. Routine lab studies showed hemoglobin 9.1 gram per cent, which deranged LFT. Hepatitis B and C, they were negative. Stool was negative for occult blood. A chest X-ray and barium enema, they were negative. His ECG or EKG, whatever you, way you say, showed a right bundle branch block. CT scan showed numerous masses within the lobes of the liver. A needle biopsy showed moderately differentiated SCC, that is hepatocellular carcinoma, and the patient was started on chemotherapy. 4 months after the diagnosis, the patient developed sudden decrease of the liver function. So the sudden decrease of the liver function and developed deep venous thrombosis, that's DVT of his right leg, and was admitted to the hospital. On second day, the patient developed pulmonary embolism and died 30 minutes later. So you have to write the MCCT, what you are going to write for this case. Yes, you have got a detail. One A, one B, one C, one D, you can write it down. One A is pulmonary embolism, good. You are now, it is correct. You are all correct. Those who are A, one A is the pulmonary embolism. One B is the deep venous thrombosis, yes, good. duration, you have not mentioned the duration. That also should be there, the duration. Pulmonary embolism. Yeah, 1B is deep brain trauma, 1C is hepatocellular carcinoma. But here also you can see there is a, you have the patient develops sudden decrease in the liver function. That also you have to take into consideration, because deep venous thrombus developed because of that only. If you go through that, why this DVT occurred? So you have to mention that in your death certificate, that this was also there. So if you want to mention that, so what will happen now? And what about part two? Yeah, whatever you are writing, whatever you are, it's quite correct. If you write SCCL 1C, but you have to take into consideration why this DVT occurred. The DVT occurred because of the decrease in liver function. There is a associated liver failure that may have occurred that has resulted in deep venous thrombosis. So what you are going to write in part A, pulmonary embolism 30 minutes, deep venous thrombosis 2 days, and acute hepatic failure. Because of that only he may have developed this deep venous thrombosis. And he is the hepatocellular carcinoma for over 4 months. He is diagnosed with that. And what will be in part two, that may have caused this SCC, then be chronic alcoholic liver disease and hypertension. Yeah, so I hope it is clear now. So you should have, before writing, I say with some, ask that why not hypertension? Yeah, you can write in part two hypertension also, in 1B also hypertension, but it may be a case where he was having hypertension for the last 5 years and it may have contributed to it, may have not have, so intracerebral hemorrhage itself may cause death of the person, that's why. So it, depending on the case, it's not that it's very rigid in that it should be there only, that that hypertension should be there in part two. It may not be, depending on the case, you can change it. It's a dynamic one, right? So real case discussion, little bit of real cases, which I've just got some images of it. You can let me know what are the things which are missing here. So you can see here, I'll finish it fast, so it's already 3:45, and I've got 15 minutes, so I'll just discuss. You can see that, what are the things which you think, you know, till now what you have discussed and what is wrong with this cause of death? What is wrong with this? What is wrong with this? Short form use. Abbreviation. What else do you think? Not written in capital letters. Yes. That also is pardonable if you write it legibly. Yes. Not capital 1A. Yeah, you can see that nothing is there in 1A. Makes it. You can see that it's just a diagnosis that the person, the doctor has copied from the file. Yeah? It's acute history of high voltage electric current with arm disarticulation, right, this other side, the right arm disarticulation with acute kidney injury, with hyperkalemia, with sepsis, and in the last he has written, he or she has written cardiopulmonary arrest. It's not written in sequence, yes, good. Yes, and the duration also, it's in end block, it's set in 10 days. We're not sure what has done, like 10 days and died because of that. Yes, anything else? What should be a sequence? Someone has mentioned, yeah. You have mentioned not written in sequence, yes. What should be a sequence like? Someone has mentioned, hyperkalemia and sepsis, good. it should be written in 1A. You can write it, yeah, hyperkalemia. You can write 1A hyperkalemia, sepsis, maybe 2-3 days, maybe there. So yeah, actually, if you go through the file, there's no need to know when the sepsis has developed. But hyperkalemia, yes, it is fatal. Sepsis may be there before that. And it can be or you can write together 1A and then 1B can be acute kidney failure. Yeah, 1B can be because of it that hyperkalemia is there. And then we have that D, 1B, 1C can be electric burn. That actually it is the electrocution or electric burn that has started this. So you have got, yeah, burn is there in 1C. So you can write first hyperkalemia, then you can write sepsis, acute kidney failure, and then electric burn. Yeah, you can write in that manner. And cardiopulmonary arrest should not be written. Again, I am mentioning, repeating the same thing, that it should not be written. Next, we have another one. You can see here what's missing and what should be there. It's post-COVID death. You can see that. What is wrong with this? What's wrong with this death certificate? Again, the same thing. You can see that, yeah, abbreviation is there. Cardiopulmonary arrest being written. Time is missing. Yes, good. Yeah. Etiology is not mentioned, but you can go through that. The other thing that has been mentioned, you can write that it is pneumothorax is there, the sepsis. You can write first the 1A will be pneumothorax, then we have sepsis, then 1C can be post-COVID-19 syndrome or post-COVID-19 death disease. That has caused the sequence. It may be, yeah, pneumothorax. It can be then we can have sepsis, post-COVID-19 disease. And the duration is not mentioned. Yes. Next, we have another case. Here you can see again, here it is mentioned cardiopulmonary arrest, 1A. Then you have a known case of severe COVID pneumonitis, known case of acute of chronic alcohol, CLD, I think. So again, the abbreviation CLD, chronic liver disease, on mechanical ventilator with septic shock, on inotropes. So again, it is some diagnosis that has been copy-pasted here. You can see. So what should be the sequence? In this, even the interval is not being mentioned. What should be the sequence here? Yeah, septic shock, yes, good now. 1A is the septic shock, 1B. 1B. What should be 1B? Pneumonitis. Yeah, COVID pneumonitis, yeah, good. Pneumonia, and third will be the C, you can write. COVID-19, post-COVID-19 syndrome or disease. So statistically, it will take as COVID-19 death, the complications of COVID-19 death. Yeah, good. Now here, you can see very well, it is totally wrong and it may enter into some trouble. Why is it so? It's the cause of death where you have written, someone has written that, in the right, part two, chronic alcoholic, good, and CLD. Part two will be chronic alcoholic and CLD, yeah, good. Duration is not mentioned there. Here, the broad date cases, you are not going to issue a cause of death certificate. You have to mention, you have to send the police information and write a MLR. For postmortem exam, you don't know what is the cause of death? What is mean by all this? I'm not sure. Broad death, cardiopulmonary arrest. So it is totally wrong. Here it is in a natural death. You can see that adenocarcinoma with intestinal obstruction with shock with serious sepsis, then B, adenocarcinoma, cardiopulmonary arrest. So it is very confused. The person is very confused what to write. So what could be the sequence? And the interval is also not mentioned. What could be the sequence here in this case? Yes, sepsis. First, yes, good. One is sepsis. Second, one B will be septic shock. Yeah, good. One B will be. So septic shock, 1A is fine. Septic shock, 1B will be intestinal obstruction. Intestinal obstruction is there. And 1C will be adenocarcinoma. See, adenocarcinoma colon with intestinal obstruction. Yeah, 1B will be intestinal obstruction. And 1C will be adenocarcinoma. So then the sequence is complete. And you have to write the duration also. Yes, good. Good. So cardiopulmonary arrest is not required here. So it is unnecessarily, it has been written. So some suggestions, it's that the MCCD should be countersigned by the doctor in charge, then only then it will be better written by the residents, should be countersigned by the doctor in charge. The student should discuss with the resident doctors preparing the MCCD whenever they are posted in the wards or emergency. So whenever you are there, if there is a death is there and the doctor is filling in up that seat and discuss what should be the, how to write with the sequence, you can discuss, so you can develop or learn further. A research survey, you can do a research survey, can be done by the students to know the level of information among the residents and other doctors regarding the MCCD. This is for you, the students, you can do a research survey in your own institute to see the knowledge and attitude and the level of knowledge they have for this MCCD. So these are some of my suggestions to you, and the take home message I'll just give that all the columns need to be filled up. If there is nothing, you can make a dash in front of it. There is nothing to write it down, make a dash. Understanding the pathology and the underlying pathology of the underlying and the contributory causes of death is essential for the certificate. So whenever you are writing the cause of death, you should understand the pathology of the underlying and the contributory cause of death. Then only you will be able to write this MCCD. The underlying cause of death which started the sequence should be last entry under the part one. So I have mentioned that the last entry which is there in the part one is the underlying cause of death. So that all started the sequence of event. The mode of death, like the cardiac arrest, respiratory arrest, or ventricular fibrillation, should not be used as these terms are cumbersome, immaterial, and are not useful at all. So remember that you are not going to write all these terms while writing the cause of death. And thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful presentation. I hope all delegates will get some insights from this topic. We have now Q/A session, sir. Sir, a small permission needed from you. Before Q/A session, I want to share the small JP flyers, sir.
Yeah, the MCD and death certificate, that's an issue, which is commonly when the doctors are saying MCCD and death certificate, they use it synonymously, but death certificate, that is issued to the relatives, it's not the same one. They do not mention the cause of death sequence. It is not given to them. That is used for statistical purpose only. It's not given to the relatives.
Okay, sir. I request the students to kindly drop their questions in the YouTube chat box. So I will see and I will ask you, sir.
Form 6, I think it is for maybe just a second, maybe was perinatal deaths or I'm not sure. I'll check it and let you know, Dr. Mara.
Sir, what if we have to wait for?
Sir, we have a question. Yeah.
What if we have to wait for the toxicology report?
I didn't get the question. What is the question?
Sir, what if we have to wait for the toxicological report?
No, this is for natural. The MCCD is for the natural death.
Okay, sir.
Natural death which has occurred, if it is there, if you suspect that it is a poisoning case, you have to send it to postmortem examination. There only the cause of death and that is to be given by the there only.
Okay. You can wait for further.
The death certificate that is issued to the relatives that doesn't mention the cause of death here. It is for statistics. It is there, which we send it. It is there for statistical purpose. It is not given to the relatives. Okay, any other question?
Yes, sir. I'm waiting, sir. Like there will be a small delay, 30 seconds to 1 minute in from Zoom to YouTube. So I'm waiting for the questions from the YouTube live chats. Any questions, viewers from YouTube, please drop it in the YouTube live chat so that I can ask sir the questions.
Yes, you should fill it only where the cause of death you are sure of. When you are treating the patient.
Sir, we got a question, sir. Sir, if death occurs at home and the person is not brought to the hospital, how will be the MCCD be given?
If the doctor was treating that patient, if he is sure of the cause of death, that he died of natural, then he should fill the non-institutional form. Form 4A for the cause of death. And if he's not sure, then he will ask for postmortem, definitely. Not issue any death certificate.
Okay, sir. Sir, if the identity of the deceased is not known, but mode and cause of death are known, is the death registered?
No, without the unknown person, it will not be registered. In the statistical for that purpose, I have mentioned that it is required. The name, the particulars of the patient, cause, that is to be there for registration.
Okay. You can wait for further 1 minute, sir. If not, I will proceed for the vote of time. Sir, in case of accidents, if patient's relatives aren't there, can a MCCD be issued?
If patient relatives aren't there, can a In accident, they are all for medical legal postmortem. Cannot issue a MCCD. Any accident there is sent for postmortem examination.
Okay, sir.
Even you may be aware that for accident cases, we have to diagnose everything is there. When a death occurs, it is sent for postmortem examination.
Okay, sir.
Final cause of death is issued by the postmortem, the autopsy surgeon. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Professor. Professor,
that what is the form number 1A1 all that? Give a detail of it. Thank you, Dr. Madan.
Yes, sir. I think there are no more doubts from the students. We are not getting any through YouTube live chat also.
Yeah, thank you for your patient hearing. Thank you.
Yes, sir. I will proceed for the vote of thanks. Sir, please stay for 2 minutes so that we can have a photo. So, my sincere thanks to JP and Dr. Gautam Biswas, sir, for taking a lecture on our platform. We felt very honorable and grateful to have you here. I hope all delegates enjoyed this session. And if any first year students or second year students are there, they can buy SAR's book of forensic medicine and they can use it for their academic purposes. And we have received a few comments from the students in YouTube live chat, sir, that they have used your book and it was very useful for them. So
thank you
everyone. So have a nice day.
Thank you, Dr. Gautam Biswas. Thank you very much.
Thank you.